Hello there. Well, depending on your point of view, good-looking telescopes are hardly rare. But maybe telescopes that look good and perform well are a little bit rarer. But maybe it's a question of handsome is as handsome does, and we're not too happy about stressing the apparently trivial considerations of form and looks over function, especially with a piece of equipment so ruthlessly functional as a modern telescope. But there really is no reason in principle why an instrument shouldn't look good and perform well. Bear that in mind as we look at the new AZ-EQ Avant mount and telescope family. They're new from Sky Watcher, and they really are a handsome bunch. And I'm going to tell you all about them right after this. So, the gang's all here. There are three models in the Avant range. They are all telescopes we've seen before. There is the 114 Skyhawk, the 130mm parabolic Expolorer, and the 102mm Skymax. We've encountered these telescopes before on the range, and it's good to see them in action again because they're such great scopes. Let's just tick off the salient details of the three kits, especially in view of the mounting, which of course is the same on all three. So the one thing these telescopes have all got in common is the Avant mount, but the sharp-eyed may spot that there are small differences between them. In actual fact, the kits, apart from the optics, are the same for the 102 and the 114 in virtue of this smaller size counterbalance weight, and you can see the 102 has got the smaller counterbalance weight as well. But the Expolorer 130, in virtue of being a larger telescope, has a larger 2.3 kilo counterbalance weight just to command the slightly different weights of the telescope. And that's it really. So once we've got that out the way, the counterbalance weights, everything else about the mounting, the Avant mount downwards, is exactly the same. So they all come equipped with this now well used now and very versatile lightweight tripod, all aluminium construction. We've seen this used on the Pronto, the AZ-5, the AZ-GTI, and we've also seen it used as the tripod of choice for the Star Adventurer. So literally thousands of these now in circulation, many thousands in fact, and getting a good press all round. So a good battle-tested tripod is being supplied as the fundamental support for the Avant. All come supplied with an extension tube. We haven't bothered putting it in place on the 114 and the 130 because we didn't think it really needed it, but we have got one in play here on the Skymax. Without the extension tube, the tripod up to this point here is about 112 centimeters, and with this in place, that brings the top here up to 135 centimeters. So with that and the fact that the legs are fully adjustable, you've got everything you need to put the eyepiece at an ideal and comfortable observing height. Let's just look at the two reflectors in the family first. Again, both of these are firm favorites. We've got the 114 parabolic Skyhawk and the 130 parabolic Expolorer. Both of these again are tried and tested instruments. You've seen them before on the channel. I'm not going to labour the benefits of them for too long because you can go back and look at our back catalogue at the AZ Pronto and the AZ-5 areas, and also the Skyhawk is, I think we actually deal with the Skyhawk on its own elsewhere on the channel, so you might want to go and have a look at that. So I'm just going to give you the salient points. The Skyhawk is equipped with the standard red dot finder, which makes the instrument, I think, very easy to use. I'm a big fan of this type of red dot finder. It has a 1¼-inch rack and pinion focuser supplied. It's mounted onto the Avant via a set of tube mounting rings. Now, The tube mounting rings are themselves mounted on a dovetail mounting bar. That's the, and you can see it's finished in this rather handsome metallic green, which is part of the new corporate style and livery of Skywatcher these days. So whether you like green or not is rather beside the point. It's what you get, okay? A nice thing about the ring choice here is that because it's a German equatorial mount, it is possible for the eyepiece to end up in some pretty weird positions when you're using the telescope. You can see it can end up pointing at the ground and it can end up being quite inconvenient. But because it's tube mounted, we can easily just slacken these off and put the eyepiece in whatever position is most comfortable for the observer. So that's really quite a useful feature. Also, we can rebalance the telescope as well. So if we've got a camera mounted here, so there's a bit more weight at the front end, we can always position the tube back slightly so that we've got a greater mass of the telescope at the rear here to counterbalance naturally the front weight, the additional front weight caused by the camera. So again, rings are a nice solid traditional way of mounting this sort of telescope on a German equatorial mount. Both of the instruments are supplied with the standard modified achromat eyepieces, the 25mm and the 10. Now, we've had quite a bit to say about these eyepieces in the past, and I'm not going to repeat it here. Suffice it to say that these eyepieces could be better. Skywatcher should not be put in the stocks, really, for supplying these. Almost everybody supplies this kind of eyepiece with the instrument, and they really are to get you going. So think of them a bit like the batteries you get when you buy anything with a remote on it these days. You get a set of batteries in there that'll get you going. These eyepieces are pretty much the same. Maybe that's a little bit unfair. The 26 here is actually not that bad an eyepiece, and it will work reasonably well. But the 10 could definitely be a lot better. And in principle, if you wanted to treat your telescope, maybe buy a couple of better eyepieces, but certainly improve this 10. Think about, for both of these and the Skymax as well, think about upgrading this by buying maybe a 12.5mm plus, or that would be an ideal alternative. That would let you put this one back in the drawer and not worry about it too much. Anyway, all three telescopes come with those two eyepieces. So what can we see with these instruments? Well, the 114 is a very good size to begin an astronomical observing career. This will give you good views of the moon, planets. It's capable of sustaining magnifications up to about 230 and ideal conditions, maybe a little bit more, 230 times. You'll need to buy additional accessories to be able to get hold of that magnification. And one of the things I also like to say to people as well, that with a telescope of this size, you'll need something like at least 10 magnifications to go from low power to high power. So it's probably a good idea to equip yourself with a Barlow. My preference would be a Barlow that functions at 2x or 1.5x times magnification. That's not included in the kit. That would have to be on your list of treats for yourself with this instrument, things to add to it, but a Barlow would be a good contender. And maybe split those two eyepieces. It comes with the 10 and the 25. I suggested you go with a 12.5, but maybe get a 17 or a 20. Again, that's going to work well with the Barlow and give you a good range of magnifications to use with the instrument. Looking at the 130, similar in terms of design and look, but obviously a lot bigger, 650mm focal length here, as opposed to 500mm focal length on the 115. So straight away, those same eyepieces are going to deliver immediately higher magnifications when used with this telescope, and that's in virtue of the larger, longer focal length. The primary mirror, again, tried and tested, this 130mm parabolic, been used in a lot of Skywatcher telescopes and is very definitely a firm favorite. The method of mounting is exactly the same. We've got these tube rings so that we can move the telescope backwards and forwards very easily. Got a rather more substantial focuser, 1¼-inch focuser on the Explorer, with a T-thread mounted on here so that you can add camera T-mount rings directly to the focuser. We've also got the standard red dot finder on there as well. Magnifications with this telescope running up to around about 250, maybe 260 times. Again, additional accessories required. Probably exactly the same accessories I think would work well for this that I was describing for the 114. The instrument is larger, and it's worth bearing in mind that the manufacturer's declared payload weight for the Avant is 3 kilos. Now, in my tests and playing around with it, I would say this can easily carry another 500 grams on top of that, so 3.5 kilos comfortably and without any difficulty, may even as high as 4 kilos. But the published maximum payload weight is actually 3 kilos. Bear in mind, we've got a counterbalancing weight of 2.3 kilos in here. That's not normal to add that into the payload weight, so we've still got 3 kilos clear. But even without an eyepiece, this telescope tube actually weighs 3.2 kilos. So that's just worth bearing in mind, that this instrument is already taking this mount pretty much to its limit, and certainly on paper. I think if I was Sky Watcher, I'd probably up that minimum, or rather maximum payload weight, and I'd put another 500 grams on that just to be on the safe side. And I don't think that's not playing with the truth. I think 3 kilos is a bit low actually for this mounting. I've put weight on it beyond 4 kilos, and it performed pretty much okay. So I don't think that's that much of a problem. Just putting the Skymax here front and center. We've looked at this instrument before as well. Tried and tested, we've got a 1300 mil focal length folded up in here. Don't forget, this is an optically folded design, so the light comes in through the corrector, down onto the primary, back up to the secondary, back down again, blah, 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 blah. Straighten that out and we've got a whacking 1300 mil of focal length. Again, like the other two telescopes, this is strictly an astronomy telescope. Because of its design and the fact that it comes with a 90 degree star diagonal at the back here, and don't forget, this is mainly designed so that you can make your observations up in the night sky without getting a crick neck, it would allow you to make terrestrial observations. So basically, if you set this down a little bit lower, maybe got rid of the extension here, you could set this telescope comfortably to make terrestrial observations. But bear in mind, it would need to be things like ships on the horizon. If you point this at a bird on your bird table, you're going to see the beak. It's too much magnification. 1300 mil with either of the two eyepieces supplied is going to be significantly overpowered for normal terrestrial observing, you know, things in your garden and in the middle distance. If you're looking at ships on the horizon, fine, this could be a good instrument to do that. But it is, first and foremost, an astronomy telescope. And really, that's what brings us to looking, I think, at the mount, because it's the mount that really determines that these are great astronomy telescopes. Okay, that's the optics out the way. Let's take a look at the star of the show, the Avant combined EQ and alt-azimuth mounting. This is a very handsomely engineered little unit, and it's a development of their very popular old EQ1, which was carrying telescopes very similar to this historically, but I think it's a much more elegant looking piece of engineering, and I think it's combined to make a very modern looking telescope. Let's just show you the most obvious thing about it, the ability to be set up in, at the moment, the German equatorial mount mode. If I want to set it up in Altaz mode, it's very simple to do. I slacken off this screw, you can see it on this side. I slacken this off and simply turn this knob. And you can see I can take the mount up until I put it in the 90 degree altazimuth position. So what does that mean, altazimuth? Well, this is altitude and this is azimuth. Rotation in east-west and altitude rotation in altitude north-south. So you can see, really, when we look at the telescope, how easy it is to put it in that form. Once it's done, all I've got to do is lock that off. And it's achieved, really, with this very nice worm and gear system here. So there's none of this business with the two screws pushing like on the old EQ1 and EQ2. In fact, as used on most German equatorial mounts, in fact. This is the kind of engineering you don't normally see except on a much more expensive mount. Now, the sharp-eyed among you will probably recognize this as an accessory for the Star Adventurer. Do bear in mind that this is not the same as the one from the Star Adventurer. So if you take one of these apart, hoping to fit it directly to your Star Adventurer, I'm afraid you're going to be sadly disappointed. This is only superficially similar. It's been made to the same standard, and it certainly looks the part, but this flange at the top here is really quite different to anything you'll find used on the Star Adventurer. Like that. So just looking at the actual mounting itself, there's a lot to like on this little mount. I like the locks on it. They're really very large that allow the instrument to be moved to new positions. They can be done with just the tips of your fingers. They're in obvious locations. They present themselves directly next to one another. There's no reaching around the mount and wondering where they've gone after the telescope has moved in the dark. They are always easy to find because they're right next to one another. And that's the same for the slow motions as well. It's quite normal for a little mount like this to allow the declination slow motion knob to have a life completely independent of the RA knob. But you can see with this little mount, I can operate the slow-mos basically with the same hand, and they don't change their position. Look, no matter where this one goes, this one stays in exactly the same position. What does that mean for me as a user? It means that if I'm very comfortably observing with the telescope in one particular position, I'm very, very close to the mounting. It's very comfortable. I'm not having to reach back for slow motion knobs or anything like that, or reach around to any odd uncomfortable position. My hand always goes to exactly the same position when I'm operating the scope, and it's an ideal observing position for the user. Another nice thing about this, take an Allen key to this knob, simply undo the grub screw and remove it, and you can shove it on the other side. So if you're left-handed or for whatever reason you might want it on the other side, that's easily done. It's a matter of a few seconds just to transfer the knob onto the other side. You can operate them obviously independently on this, but you can move the top knob there as well, the declination knob. That can also go onto the other side there. What is it that's so nice about the Avant? Well, I think it's the it's a very pleasing package in terms of how well it works. It functions very well, it feels good, and it looks nice. Remember those comments I made at the start of this video? That was really what I had in mind. This is a mounting that doesn't only perform well, it looks good as well, and really does make a very nice modern statement if you're going to have this telescope set up in your living room or up against a nice window or at the top of the stairs. Why not have something that looks good and performs well as well? Let's just look at it in a little bit more detail. I just want to show you this without the telescope tube in place so that we can look at the mount kind of independently. I'll just bring that round so that you can see it. The top plate there is kind of, it's got a rubberized disc on it to make a soft connection with whatever product you were intending to put on here. But obviously this is threaded quarter UNC or quarter Whitworth, so standard tripod fitting, and you can really see how compact this little mount is here. I'm just going to show you the adjustment as well for the counterbalance shaft. As I wind the telescope up to put it in the 2Altaz mode, I think if you were using either of the two lightweight telescopes, you could probably dispense with the counterbalance shaft and use it without, because the payload weight here, take that over a little bit, the payload weight here with either the 114 or the Skymax is sufficiently light that I don't think it would be a problem. I think if you were going to use the 130 in LTAS mode, you would want the counterbalance shaft here in play to make sure that the telescope didn't become unstable. So the one point to draw your attention to here really is that the dihedral on the tripod legs is quite narrow. This angle at the top here is quite narrow, so that if the weight of the instrument, in this case the 130, being on one side and in between the tripod legs, it would make the mount a little bit unstable. So it would be a good idea to have the counterbalance weight in place, even if you weren't using it in the German equatorial mode. Okay, I think with the other two instruments, you can go without this. So if this was causing an obstruction in the way or something like that, in LTAS mode with the smaller instruments, I think you'd be okay. I think with the larger instrument, I think you should leave it on, basically, because it's going to counteract the instrument and stop it becoming unstable. That's about it, I think, for the Avant. I've given you a sort of an overview of this product. I like it. I think it's a very handsome instrument. It's strong enough to support all of the telescopes that are supplied on it. They are all astro telescopes, including the Skymax, so none of these instruments are really suitable for terrestrial viewing, although you could just about press the Skymax maybe into viewing at high magnification if you had distant shipping to look at or something like that. But they all, I think, make for a very handsome instrument to have as a part of a modern home if the instrument is going to be on display or on view. Anyway, that's it for now. We look forward to seeing you again soon. Don't forget to subscribe if you want to see more like this. Bye for now.